Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to our workshop jointly arranged by WWF and the Institute for the Law of the Sea and International Marine Environmental Law, ISRIM, which is based in Bremen. My name is Stefan Luther. I come from the International Center for Marine Conservation of WWF in Hamburg, and together with my friend André Kirchner from ISRIM, we will guide you through this workshop and moderate the workshop. You see a slight change compared to what has been printed and announced. The parliamentarian from the outgoing European Parliament, Mr. Kriton Arsenis, was not available to provide a video message on deep sea fishing. It's due to the electoral campaign, which is running now. They are all very busy, but I will try to include this issue in my introductory slides, because I have also worked on that part. But the focus of our workshop is indeed deep sea mining, and we raise the question whether deep sea mining activities, for example, in EU waters or by European member states, governments or consortiums in overseas waters, including on the high seas and international waters, is something we can afford and which is compatible with the need to protect marine biodiversity in the deep sea, and where are the limits to such blue growth. That's what we are talking about here. And to that end, we want to enlighten you first with our four main speakers, which you see on the list and also on the printed leaflet in the room, which you can take home. About the facts, both in terms of environmental policies and legal conditions for potential deep sea mining, seabed mining. I start with the first short introduction without the legal perspective, because that's the speciality of my partner André from ISRIM, not mine. Myself, I'm a marine ecologist and working on marine policies, and both in the EU and in the Northeast Atlantic in particular. You have seen it in the video, in the movie trailer from by Sarah Cyrul already. It's a really recommendable movie. Deep sea biodiversity might be at stake by such activities. And we have already the definition of what is called a vulnerable marine ecosystem. It has, in the deep sea, it has entered the international agenda, mainly in the fishing arena. So these habitats and ecosystems are hydrothermal vent fields, so-called smokers, cold water coral reefs or gardens, seamounts and community and their communities, and also deep water sponge aggregations. On the right-hand corner of this picture, you also see the deep sea manganese nodule fields from the Pacific, which is not included in this fishing terminology yet, because there's nobody fishing there. But I would also say this is also something like vulnerable deep sea marine ecosystem, and we know too little about the impacts of such activities. And this is what I say, what was announced as an introduction by, or video message by a parliamentarian who was the rapporteur for the deep sea regulation, deep sea fishing regulation of the European Union. He cannot contribute that, so I try to comprise the essence of what he could have said. We have United Nations provisions to protect such vulnerable marine ecosystems from bottom trawling. I'm talking fishing now. We have draft EU legislation which passed Parliament in 2012, in December. We have, on a case-by-case basis, already many closed areas. For example, in the Northeast Atlantic, it's an area almost as big as the German Federal Republic. And also in the Mediterranean, bottom trawling is completely banned below a certain depth. And we have a debate whether such a general ban would also be possible in EU waters. That's still to be decided by Council and Parliament. So the question is, when protecting such vulnerable marine ecosystems from harmful bottom trawling, why not from extraction as well? And if you look at these two maps, on the left-hand side, you see the network of marine protected areas in the Northeast Atlantic, including the high seas. You will see there are many gaps, especially in offshore and deeper waters, and where such protected areas already exist, it's not automatically the case that deep sea mining is prohibited there. On the right-hand side, you see, for example, the existing fisheries closures, which I refer to in this area. These are the green and red areas on that map. And that map also shows you the boundaries of the extended continental shelf claims by European coastal states. So they claim the sovereignty over the seafloor and its resources in that area and have notified that to the United Nations Commission responsible. Finally, my last slide, we are talking about blue growth here. This is a policy by the European Union, and I'm quoting from the key quotes that apply to what we are doing here today in this workshop from the document from 2012, What is Blue Economy? The blue economy needs to be sustainable and to respect potential environmental concerns given the fragile nature of the marine environment. And there's a particular chapter on marine mineral resources saying by 2020, 5% of the world's minerals, including cobalt, copper, and zinc, could come from the ocean floors. This could rise to 10% by 2030. And it's talk about a huge amount of big money of 10 billion euros in that business. The most promising deposits are said to be found in metallic sulfides in EU waters, which emerge from hydrothermal vents or deposits. It's also stated in that document that EU engagement would help to ensure that high environmental, legal, and security standards are upheld. So we have to ask, is this true? And it's also saying this includes protecting the marine environment in line with the provisions of the United Nations Law of the Sea, UNCLOS, to which the EU and all its member states are contracting parties. And we know there's an international seabed authority at least setting standards for seabed mining in those areas that are common heritage of mankind, the area.